Morning. That was a good rousing start to the service. It's a light service this morning. I'll try not to take it personally. But Tim and Shelley and the rest of the 1040 team are currently sitting on an airplane, wondering how many more hours they got left to go. They got on a plane. Well, let's start with Friday. They got to the parking lot here on Friday at 2 p.m. They left in a van, went up to San Francisco, stayed the night in San Francisco, and then the next day they were taken to San Francisco Airport. At 2 p.m., they left on a flight to Paris, and then had a short turnaround in Paris, and then frustrating, I'm sure, every time I've been to Paris, same thing. It's a nightmare of an airport. I won't say why. And then they got on a flight at 4:30 this morning, our time, to go to Abidjan. And Tim sent me a picture of the plane. It's one of the Airbus, the double-decker Airbus, that they're going to Abidjan. So they're currently still on that, expecting to arrive around noon our time in Abidjan. But then it's not over. So then they've got to get on a bus. And then they've got to go for hours and hours, 10, 11, 12 hours, actually more probably. The roads have got a little better since the previous year, but up to the northern part of Ivory Coast, Doropo, where they will finally get to their destination sometime tomorrow. So long, long journey to get there. But I did see on their Facebook page, the 1040 Facebook page, that they have an air-conditioned bus this year. So that's a good start. It will be a relief for them when they get there. It'll probably be really cool, so they won't need it. So also yesterday in the parking lot, so that was 2 p.m., 3:30, the 4th through 6th graders, 13 of them, set off in various vehicles to go up to Heartland Camp for their winter camp. So there's 13 kids up there, two counselors. My wife is one of them, so I'm struggling to get through the weekend, I might add. She is my organization, and I still have two kids out of the three. So we'll just keep them in mind as they finish up. They're in chapel right now, and then they have some activities this morning. They'll be heading back after lunch today, get back about 2 p.m. Announcements. So there's a deacons meeting at 10:45 today after this service. Rich Smith will be doing a meeting for people that are interested in deacon, deaconess positions here in the church. So go to that if you're interested in that sort of thing. Men's Bible study. Thursday morning, we're starting a new Bible study. So Tuesday night, we're continuing with Acts. We're still going through the book of Acts. Thursday morning, we are starting a new one. It starts at 6 a.m. Thursday mornings, it goes to 6:45. Coffee's on at 5:45 if you're one of those people that just really likes to get up really early in the morning, which is not me. So we're starting a new Tony Evans study called Watch Your Mouth. And that's kind of about the spoken word and how the spoken word can honor God. So come along if you're interested in the new Bible study. It's a right now, so it has a video study plus some chat, and it'll probably take a few weeks, well, knowing this group, a little longer than that. But it should be fun. It's a good group of guys, so come along if you're interested in that. Speaking of men's activities, you know, this year we've changed the men's breakfast a little bit. It used to be once a quarter, but this year it starts, we had one in January, and then it's every odd month. Not strange as an odd, but every odd number month. So, but we're not going to just let it go at that. On the months that we don't have men's breakfast, there will be an activity for men on that second Saturday. So this coming Saturday, on the 11th, we're going to do racing. MB2 racing. It's not like an organized event. It's just if you want to do racing with the guys from New Hope, then turn up at 11 a.m. and we're going to get into teams and see who's the fastest out of all of us. I did this with my company a while back, and I realized that when I was racing against 20-something-year-olds, there's a little bit of difference in how daring you are when you go around the corners. So it didn't quite go the way I wanted it to, because I wanted to beat everyone that worked for me. But that did not happen. So anyway, so we'll see who the New Hope champion can be, and we'll probably announce that next Sunday. February 12th, that's next Sunday, there's an informational meeting if you're interested in the Mexico mission trip. So Chris will be doing a meeting at 12:30 or after the third service about the Mexico mission trip. If you're interested in going or you have a child that's interested in going, go to that, find out more information about it, and then you'll be set to get started on that process. Also, a calendar item, February 14th, Valentine's Day, which is nice. It's a prime timer's lunch. So if you want to take your Valentine to a luncheon, then or find a Valentine at the luncheon. Then February 14th is the senior luncheon, 55 plus. If you go normally, you kind of know the drill. If you've never been before, just turn up and see what that's all about. They'll be talking, they'll have two local gardening experts talking about how you can use all this rain that we've been having to your benefit. So you can actually water this summer probably, so you can actually use some of the water that we've got in order to grow things in your garden. Baptism, if you're interested in baptism, we will be doing another baptism Sunday coming up in early spring. So just write down on one of the visitor cards or one of the note cards in front and put it in the offering if you're interested in being baptized this year. We already have a pretty good group of people, so if you want to be added to that list, just let us know. Or call the office if you want to do it that way. Maureen is going to talk to us about the Women's Spring Event, which is a craft luncheon.
Yeah, coming up on Saturday, February 25th, we're going to be having a ladies' luncheon and craft day, and it'll be from 10 o'clock till 1 o'clock over in the bridge. Our craft for the day is going to be, and I don't know how many of you ladies are like me, but if somebody walks into my home and says, here, here's a plant inside, I think, this is not going to go well for the plant. I have to water them, and it just doesn't happen in my home. So what we're going to be doing as our craft is we're going to be making a terrarium, and inside that we're going to have succulents, which I have taken this class, and mine is still thriving. It requires very little water and next to nothing as far as maintenance. So our event is going to be $15, and we're going to be selling tickets out here in the pavilion after this service, and we'll also be selling them next weekend if anybody would like to come.
Thanks, Maureen. A much better job than I did at the 8 o'clock service. I kind of looked at it and said, oh, it's a fishbowl with plants in, and so, but it looks fun, so. And now Ryan is going to talk to us. Has anyone been on the new website? We started a new website. Ryan put it together, so he's going to tell you a little bit about that.
Hello, everyone. I'm Ryan. I'm the IT guy here. If you haven't checked it out yet, I'd rather let my work speak for itself. Just newhopechurch.net is the new website. Let us know what you think, what you like, don't like. Feedback is great. And also, coming up in the next couple months, we have a church app that I'm developing, so that will be a nice add-on as well. And as well as, if you haven't already, every Sunday we record all of the sermons, so they're online to watch and listen to. So I do recommend you do that. Also trying to make a push to get it on YouTube as well. So they're on there, working on getting the older ones on there, but it's all in the process. So go ahead, check it out. We're trying to increase our online presence so we can reach a new crowd that we don't normally reach. So thank you very much.
Thanks, Ryan. Yeah, he's done a really good job. The website looks really good. He's done a great job with it. And so I'd encourage you to check that out. Also, Facebook, you know, this is one of the things that we do in Facebook is to keep everyone up to date with what's going on throughout the week. So we post pictures or information on Facebook. So if you're on Facebook, like us, and then check out what's going on through the week with pictures and stuff as we do it. So City Fest, we've been talking about City Fest for a little while. It's the event in April 1st, 2nd, which is the Luis Palau revival that's going to be here in Fresno, Clovis area. Which will be around the Save Mart Center, all those areas, or those big pieces of land around that area. So if you're interested in advertising City Fest, and this could be a good tool for you in your neighborhood. You know, if you want to advertise City Fest, we have yard signs in the office that you can pick up, and so you're able to put it on your front yard, and it will kind of, if nothing else, it could start a conversation with some of your neighbors, because it doesn't really say what it is on there. It just says it's City Fest and it's a free event and what dates it is. So it could start a conversation whether, you know, what is City Fest, and then you can have a chance to invite them to that so that they can have an opportunity to hear from Luis Palau and Andrew Palau and to hear some of the bands that are going to be there. So it's a good evangelistic tool in some ways. So we have them in the office if you're interested in putting one in your front yard. There's going to be other stuff you could do as well, flyers and door hangers and stuff like that they will give us over time. But that's the start, so it could be a good thing to pick up. All right, prayer requests. We have quite a few this morning. Please keep in your prayers the family of John Belknap. He used to come here some time ago, moved to Morro Bay. He unfortunately passed away this week of a sudden heart attack. He was only 62, so please keep his wife Cindy in prayer. The services, we have not had confirmed the date yet, but we think it's the 11th, and it'll be at Trinity over on the other side of Copper out that way. Donna Walter had outpatient surgery this past week, so keep her in your prayers. Polly Good, I just heard this morning that she's back in the hospital. Last night she went by ambulance to the hospital after chest pains, so please keep her in your prayers and make sure that everything is okay on that side. So it's not been an easy ride for Polly. Larry Sisk, his grandmother, passed away. Floyd Courtney, so keep that family in prayer. And the two Jerrys, Jerry Molinari and Jerry Brown, both recovering from surgery, so keep them in your prayers. They are doing well. Jerry Molinari is recovering well. I think the hardest thing is just keeping him from getting up and wanting to ride his bike. And so he needs to stay down and recover. Jerry Brown, you know, pray for him as he prepares for the next side of his surgery. Only half that was done. For the other half, which will be done in fairly soon. Danny Boitano, he's has a surgery coming up this week, so keep him in your prayers. Robin Hustler started chemo last week, and obviously that's a very challenging time. Sharon Baker is my wife Jennifer's cousin. She's in Southern California. And Tim outlined last week prayer request for her. She has liver cancer, which has gone into her bones, and she has fractured bones in her back and her pelvis. It was interesting. After the service last week, we went home, and her husband called. And they're down in Orange County, I think. And he said, you know, thanks for requesting prayers at your church. And I was like, okay. I was like, we didn't post the video yet, so I'm not quite sure how that. So apparently somebody here knows them, which we didn't know that. So and called him and told him that she had heard the prayer request. And so she was very touched to hear that. There's a network of churches. They know a lot of people in different parts of the country. So there's a network of churches that are praying for her. And it's really important because it's a very, very dire situation. It's really not good at all. So, but I was shocked to hear that phone call when I first got home. I was like, wow, that travels fast. Did God transfer that message somehow? But and then Donnie had his blood tests this week. Didn't quite go the way that we wanted it to. Didn't go down. They had the counts for his blood. They needed to be 150. He was at 13. It went up one from the previous time. So we just keep them in prayer for changes in numbers. So we just need it to go up. At least it didn't go down. But, you know, obviously it's a long way from being where it needs to be. So we really need to keep him in prayer to make sure that everything goes in the right direction for him. Okay, I'd like to ask our ushers to come forward and for our morning offering. Oh, husband and wife team. Okay, let's pray. Heavenly Father, we give praise and thanks to you this morning. Your power is immense. Your creation is immense. And we just acknowledge that this morning. We are thankful for the rain that you have provided to us this week, even if in a large amount in one go. But we're just grateful for all the rain that has come. And we just pray for a good season of farming coming up and good use of this rain in the coming months. We pray for our team who are on their way to the Ivory Coast. We pray for continued travel success and safety. We pray for strength as they get to one destination and get on another form of transportation ready to go to the next. And so we just pray you give them strength through this process. It's extremely tiring for them. They are our hands and feet of new hope on the red dirt of Africa. And we just pray that the work that they do, not just the physical work, but the spiritual work that they do will be successful and will make a difference in the lives of the people there. The medical, not just them, but the 82 people on that medical trip, we know what a huge difference it makes to that area every single year. And we just pray for the outcome and the surgeries that will happen through that program. Lord, we pray for the kids up at Heartland as they finish up their winter camp this morning. We pray for their safe return as they get back this afternoon, hopefully with good stories as kids reaffirm their commitment to Christ and other kids make that decision. Lord, we pray for all those this morning who had prayer requests, and not just them, but those that were unspoken, those people that are in the hearts of people here that have a need. We know that you are sufficient for all their needs, and we pray this in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. Amen. Well, so much for saving my voice for this, because sometimes some songs you just got to sing and sing them loud, and that's one of them. So I remember singing that literally standing on the red dirt in Africa about 4.5 years ago in the Ivory Coast, and it was in a village. It was, I don't know, it just affected me a lot. All right, well, we're going to be looking at Ecclesiastes 3 today. But let me tell you a story first. I heard about a preacher who was admiringly regarded for finishing his services at exactly noon. Then one Sunday, the impossible happened, and he preached until 12:30 p.m. On the way out, one of the elders angrily addressed him and said, "What happened?" And the preacher answered, "For years, I've always put a candy mint in my mouth, and I've tucked it away. And then it was usually gone at exactly noon. That way I never had to look at the clock or worry about what time it was. But this Sunday it just didn't go away until I finally realized I'd put a button in my mouth." Is this going in and out or is it consistent? Okay. I won't be going an extra half an hour this morning, don't worry, but time is an important part of what we're going to talk about this morning. And one of the questions that often seems to get asked is why we can't understand what God is trying to do in our lives. It seems like God was blessing me before, but now he's not. It seems like my prayers were being answered before, but now they're not. Things used to be easy, but now they're hard. So why is this happening? What is God doing in my life? And people want to know if there's some kind of secret to the understanding of what God is doing in their lives. Well, if there is a secret to this, it can be summed up in one word: seasons. Seasons. All of us in this room are in different seasons in our lives. Some are new parents. Others have become empty nesters. Some have just started a new job, while others are getting ready to retire. Some of you are dating. Some are newly married. Some are divorced. Well, some are working on 40 years of marriage. Some of you are new followers to Christ, while others are sitting here going, "I don't know if I understand what it means to be a Christian." Some of you are back in church after a long absence. And some here are leaders in our ministries. So we're all in different seasons. Has anyone ever said to you, "Just enjoy the season that you're in"? It's usually someone that's older or further along in life than you are, and they've already been through the season that you're in or a version of it. It usually happens when the kids are grown. They've already been through that season. So maybe your kids are still small. So they tell you, "Hey, well, you're in that season, you should enjoy it." But you just want to say to them, "Well, that's easy for you to say. You're not living with a couple of little terrorists who are constantly making a mess, changing diapers, exhausted all the time, and you haven't been on a date with your spouse in 3 years. How am I supposed to enjoy this when I'm this tired?" Well, today we're closing out one season. It's not a life season, but it's a calendar season. It's the end of the football season. The Super Bowl ends the football season for us today. But it's also very important to remember that as one season closes out, another one begins. So today, literally, a new season begins. Anyone want to guess? Not baseball. Well, Girl Scout cookie season begins today. And I'm not saying this because I have girls selling Girl Scout cookies. There are lots of girls in the church selling Girl Scout cookies. I'd encourage you to support them. But today is a very important day for a lot of people. Our family gets very embroiled in the Girl Scout cookie thing. My wife leads a troop of quite a few girls. So we have to go to what they call the big cookie drop every year, which I did yesterday. Now remember, my wife is not here. So 567 cases of cookies in a U-Haul truck, some of which, or a lot of which, are still in my house. So distributed to everyone so they could start selling today. So let's stop for a second and look at some stats on Girl Scout cookies, the kind of food equivalent of sports stats. The Girl Scouts managed to move almost $800 million worth of cookies every season. One quarter of that $8 million, so almost $200 million, is one cookie. Anyone want to guess? Thin Mints, right. Thin Mints, 25% of all those sales, followed by Caramel Delights. Now, you've got to remember that $800 million almost is in 6 weeks. It's only a 6-week period of time. So if you take that and analyze it, this is the accounting side of me coming out, and you analyze it for the whole year, that's the equivalent of almost $7 billion worth of cookie sales in 1 year. But I also do understand that the lure of the cookie is that it's seasonal. So if you were to sell it all year, probably the appeal would taper off somewhat fairly quickly, probably. And that's the sort of short-term pleasure is so much more desirable than the long-term availability. But that's a whole different sermon altogether. But today, as we look at the end of the football season and the start of the Girl Scout season, or Girl Scout cookie season, we need to consider that these periods of time come and go. And today we're talking about seasons. So if you have a Bible and you turn to Ecclesiastes 3, Solomon was talking about seasons in that chapter. If you've never read it, Ecclesiastes is kind of an interesting book. Scholars say that it is observational in nature. In other words, making observation about how life is rather than how life should be. So Solomon, who some say was the wisest man in the world, is writing not about how things ought to be, but about how things really are. Therefore, he writes about seasons, because that's the way we experience life, in phases and seasons. So Ecclesiastes 1 starts with, "There is a time for everything and a season for every activity under the heavens." Then it lists a lot of different seasons, some of them good, others that don't seem so good. And it implies that God brings different seasons to our lives, some of which we could stay in forever and some that we'd probably rather skip altogether. And he says there's a time for everything and a season for everything under the heavens. So then we continue reading, "A time to be born and a time to die, a time to plant and a time to uproot, a time to kill and a time to heal, a time to tear down and a time to build, a time to weep and a time to laugh, a time to mourn and a time to dance, a time to scatter stones and time to gather them, a time to embrace them and a time to refrain from embracing, a time to search and a time to give up, a time to keep and time to throw away, a time to tear and a time to mend, a time to be silent and a time to speak, a time to love and a time to hate, a time for war and a time for peace." So after listing all these seasons, Solomon says in 11, he has made everything beautiful in its time. Notice the words, "in its time." He has also set eternity in the human heart, yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. Now, we may not be as smart as Solomon was, but we have an advantage over him because we have more of the Bible available to us, more scripture available to us than he did have. So if we look at the New Testament now, Ephesians 1, 9 through 10, Paul says this, "He made known to us the mystery of his will according to his good pleasure, which he purposed in Christ, to be put into effect when the times reached their fulfillment, to bring unity in all things in heaven and earth under Christ." Paul is describing God's ultimate purpose, to bring everything in heaven and earth under rule of Christ. So Ecclesiastes is about how it's often difficult to figure out the purpose in the seasons of our lives. But Paul comes along a little later and says that now that Christ has been born for us, died for us, and has risen from the dead for us, we can now know that the purpose of God in every season is the ultimate purpose, to bring everything under the rule of Jesus Christ. That means that the seasons of life are not an accident. There's a divine timing in all of life. And if we can understand it, it helps us to live our lives a lot better. Because there are times and seasons to everyone's lives. Look at Daniel 2:20. Daniel prayed, "Praise be to the name of God forever and ever. Wisdom and power are his. He changes the times and the seasons." God changes the times and seasons of our lives, whether we realize it or not. God schedules every season of our lives. But unfortunately, he doesn't post a schedule for us to look at. And that's what makes life so difficult. That's why Solomon says, "Yet no one can fathom what God has done from the beginning to the end. No one can really see the big picture except God. No one can really understand the seasons that we go through in life except God." Paul says that from eternity, God has had a purpose that he's been working on in our lives. Our destiny was created in eternity, and God has a plan for it all. But our life is experienced in seasons. Everything that God wanted to do through your life was decided before your life ever began. But you don't experience what God wants in your life all at once. You experience it through phases and seasons throughout your life. Now, here's my problem, and probably a lot of other people's problem. I always want to skip to the next season. I struggle because I don't seem to want to be in the season I'm in. It doesn't seem like where I'm at is quite the right season. We always want to be looking at the next one. And I've been doing this my whole life. When I was in elementary school, or the equivalent in England, I always wanted to go to the next school. Because the next school looked better, cooler, kids were cooler. And I couldn't wait to get my driver's license after that. And then I couldn't wait to get out and get a job. And I couldn't wait to finish flight school. Everything I was doing, I couldn't wait for it to be over so I could get to the next phase. And in some ways, I'm still doing it today. I mean, people with little kids realize that, you know, you want to get, or any kids, you want to get through different phases quickly. When they're babies, you're like, oh, I want them to start rolling over, sitting up, and then you want them to walk. And then when they're walking, you say, well, no, I want them to be at a situation where I don't have to watch them all the time, every time they're walking. And then suddenly it's like, well, why can't we get to this phase where they can spend some time at home alone so I can go do other stuff without having them with me all the time? So, you know, and then your kids have get married, and then you want them to have kids, and it's never ending. Season after season that you want to be over and get into the next one. I don't mind apologizing for the season I want to be done right now, and that's Bible school. It's been a long 2 years, and I want that to be done with. So, but we're always waiting to get to the next season because the next season always looks better than the one that we're in. But here's a lesson from this. Every season has struggles, and they're struggles that you can't always see from the outside looking in. But what God wants to do is set us free from trying to live in someone else's season. It's hard to admit, but there's part of us that looks at other people and the season that they're in and the success that they're enjoying and the place that they've arrived at, and you're thinking, if I could just get there. If I could get there, then I'll be happy and I'll be content. That will be it for me. But the spiritual secret about seasons is that every season has its struggle. And you can't even see that or know it until you're in it. And if you get this truth deep down, it'll set you free from envy. It'll set you free from always wanting to copy someone else's circumstances. There's a struggle in every season, but the problem is when we look at other people's lives, you only see how high the tree goes. You don't see how deep the roots are planted. You only see the fruit of what someone else has, but you don't see all the hard work and struggles that it took to get there. You observe someone else's season as if you're a visitor, and it looks nice, but it's different when you live there. Have you ever been to a place you love to visit, or you visit somewhere on vacation, and you think to yourself, it's nice, but I wouldn't want to live there? Jennifer and I went to Rome about 13 years ago. Beautiful city. Had a wonderful vacation deep in the history of the Roman Empire. We toured a lot of different churches, went to the Vatican, and it was fantastic. It's a beautiful country. You can't argue that the food is some of the best in the world. But then you think about living there. It's really expensive. And not just that, everyone in Italy is really laid back, which sounds like a good thing. Until you're trying to get stuff done and you're trying to get through things, construction, build a house or repair stuff, no one does anything in any timely fashion. It will drive you completely crazy. But it looks good when you're a visitor. But it's different when you live there. And that's how we are with seasons of our lives. We see people in different seasons than us, and it looks great, but we don't see the struggles that are going on behind the scenes. The sooner we realize this, the sooner we can set ourselves free to enjoy the season that we're in. Every season has a struggle, even when we can't see it from the outside. One of the most struggle-free periods of my life, at least to outside observers, was probably when I was the CFO of a large international company. It seemed like everything was going pretty well. Life was good. We were a young couple. Well, my wife was young. I was not. We had good jobs. Financially, things were great. We bought a house, but I was miserable. I worked very long hours. I was stressed out all the time. The corporate office was in Europe, so I had to get up all hours of the night and do video conferencing, supply reports. I had to be converted from US way of doing things to European way of doing things. I was completely stressed out all the time, and it was just not enjoyable at all. So it's easy to look at someone on the surface that seems to have everything going great. But if you live their situation, you find out that they're on the edge of burnout. Every season has a struggle. Maybe you'd say, I can't relate to that. Let me tell you about the person you want to be. That's the person that you look at, and you'd love to be in their shoes. The stuff that they have that you see that makes them want you want to be them. The struggles in their season, just like you have struggle in yours. Let's look at marriage for a second. Because there was a day when you thought to yourself, if only I could just get married. But then you got married, and there were still struggles. Don't nod if you're sitting next to your spouse. It still wasn't perfect, wasn't a bed of roses, because there is a struggle in every season. And that's what Solomon talks about through the book of Ecclesiastes. He says, I wasn't content in my season. So I tried piling up wealth. But then I just had to worry about protecting and caring for all the wealth that I'd piled up. He says, I tried pleasure. But guess what? There was a hangover every morning. I tried wisdom. But there were so many books. You could wear yourself out just by reading them or find frustration in not being able to read them fast enough. Can you believe that Solomon, of all people, had all these struggles? The struggles in his seasons of life. The wealthiest guy around, any beautiful woman he wanted, he could have. Unlimited power, yet he struggled. It's like no matter how great the success, there was always an asterisk. There's so much discussion about work and life balance, especially today. So you can look at any of the top executives, or many of the top executives of large corporations in the United States, and think to yourselves, they have so much success. They have so much wealth. They have beautiful cars and houses and other trappings of success. But with this success, there's often a cost to them. Families may not have been the priorities. In fact, family may barely be there anymore because they've got so used to operating on their own. The point is, there's an asterisk because there's always circumstances that aren't apparent. And we need to realize that when we look at other people's lives, we see that other people, what other people have, and we see what they've accomplished and we haven't. There's always an asterisk. We look at them and compare ourselves to them, and it can make us feel worthless sometimes. It can make us feel like we don't measure up. And it can make us feel like, why am I not further along in my life right now? I thought I would be. But what we don't realize is that person who may seem to be ahead of us in the race of life, might have lost their wife and kids. Their health may be in tatters. There is always an asterisk or a struggle. So we need to understand and find happiness in the purpose of our season. Because our season does have a purpose, even though there's a struggle in it. Before time even began, God made plans and purposes for our lives. And if we understand the season we're in, the satisfaction and contentment will go way up. I may not have what they have, but that's all right because I'm called to do something different than they are called to do. And I'm not trying to be who they are. I'm going to stand for God in my season. I'm going to glorify God in my season and use the time I have left and the gifts that God has given me, and I'm going to rejoice in my season and yield fruit in my season. So the first truth about seasons is that every season has a struggle and we can't see it until we're in it. The second thing to learn about seasons is that every season is shaped by what we say. Every season is shaped by what we say. Think about how it's possible to prolong a miserable season by our disobedience. The classic example of this is in the Bible when the people of Israel were leaving Egypt. And they turned what should have been a couple of weeks' journey into a 40-year desert experience. Sometimes we can leave our season simply by deciding to do what God has told us to do in the first place. But there are some seasons that we're waiting on God to change, but it's not yet the right time for change. So we simply have to trust God and endure. And though we can't control the season we're going through, we can control what we say about that season. Here's an example of that. In Ecclesiastes 3:11, Solomon says, God has made everything beautiful in its time. What separates out those who walk by faith and those who just kind of wander through life aimlessly is that they choose to call a season that they're in beautiful. Do they call it based on faith or trust in God? Or do they believe that God can make something beautiful of it? Or do they call their season based on doubt and cynicism? So let me ask you a question. What do you call your season right now? Your current season? Because the truth is, what you say about your season determines how you will experience that season. In fact, your season will take on characteristics of your description of that season. So if we choose to call our season beautiful, it will become beautiful in our eyes, because we are able to recognize that it's in God's time and God makes everything beautiful in his time. I'll give you an example. Ken Brinklow, no one particularly well known, but he's a public speaker, said that without a doubt the most difficult and miserable year in his life was as a freshman at the Naval Academy. Of course, you weren't called a freshman at the Naval Academy, you're called a plebe. From the moment you showed up in early July through the following June, the goal of the Naval Academy was to put you under such great pressure and stress that you would either change your whole life or you'd quit. It was designed to be the most miserable year of your life, and for him it definitely was. Out of the 30 plebes in his company that started with him, half quit, but he didn't. And although he didn't feel it at the time, he looks back now and he recognizes that the season was beautiful in its time. Why? Because he was being shaped in ways and growing in ways, and God was doing things in him that would help him for the rest of his life. And that was beautiful. It was beautiful but miserable for him. Now, he said he wouldn't do that season for a second time, not because he wouldn't choose to. It's just he's not in that season now. God makes everything beautiful in its time. And it's not time for him to do that anymore, but it was then. And if we could just begin to recognize what God is doing in us during the season that we're in, we can start to recognize his beauty. And recognize not just the beauty, but even though sometimes it's painful, even though it's sometimes miserable, and though sometimes discouraging, God is using it in a way that will end up beautiful. And here's the thing, if we speak about a season like it's overwhelming, then it will become overwhelming. Because the way we speak about our season shapes how we experience it. Or if we speak about our season as devastating, it will become devastating. Because the way we speak about our season is the way that we will experience it. The people of Israel left Egypt and immediately started complaining and whining. They were saying, this stinks. We want to go back to Egypt. And this shaped the next 40 years of their lives. One bad attitude after another created one bad experience after another. Ken remembers when he was a plebe in the plebe year, that all of the plebs were miserable. They hated it. But Ken realized something that he had different than the other guys was the way he talked about it. I can't repeat some of the things that he said that they used to say, but basically had to do with, this place sucks, we're getting a bad deal, we hate it here. And he remembers that even as an 18-year-old, without a lot of wisdom, he still refused to join in with what they were saying. And he'd say, you chose to come here. In fact, you had to have a congressional appointment to even get in. There's thousands of other guys who would want to be here in your place. And you knew it was going to be tough before you even entered the doors. So get over it. Quit complaining. Quit whining. If you hate it so bad, just quit. And half of them did. The way you speak about your season shapes the way you experience it. Ken was miserable, just like they were, but he knew that misery was going to pay off in the end if he was able to endure. God makes everything beautiful in its time, so even if you're in a miserable season, if you speak about your season like it's a time of growth, it'll open your eyes to see the way that God is growing you, thereby shaping the way you experience your season. Even if you're in a miserable season and you talk about it like it's an opportunity to build into other people, then it opens your eyes to see that God has placed people around you and that they are influenced by you and therefore shaped by the experience that you're having in your own season. When I was 8, I went to boarding school on the south coast of England. My father was in the Royal Navy, and it was a good way to help me to get a good, consistent education. While they moved around, I didn't have to keep moving schools. Well, the first couple of weeks were miserable. We had to stay there for the first 3 weeks of the semester because going forced home always created more problems than it should. So we were forced to write letters during those first 3 weeks to our parents. Of course, they read them. It's kind of like prison. They want to make sure you're not going to give them a bad sort of impression when they understand that what parents are going through at that time. So I remember the first letter that I sent to my parents during that first week. It started with, Dear Mom and Dad, that was a good start. I want to come home. That was the first sentence. I don't think I wrote much after that. So you can imagine my poor mother at home, who's already having a tough time with it. She reads this letter and kind of comes to pieces. So even though I was young, I vividly remember the first couple of years of boarding school as being very hard. And the very beginning, it was very miserable. But over the years, I began to realize that it wasn't such a bad gig after all. I developed strong friendships, some of which I still have today. But the best part of it was I realized that I got to live with my friends all the time. It was like a continual sleepover. So my perspective changed. The season took on a whole new viewpoint, and I look back with mostly cherished memories. God made it beautiful, although my parents still not sure they agreed it was the best move because it made me fiercely independent from a very early age, and they live 5,000 miles away now. So the question is, what do we choose to say about the season that we're in? Will we speak about it, all the negative things, or will we stand with God and call it beautiful? Because God does. If you call it beautiful, then instead of only seeing the burden, we'll see the beauty, and it'll change the way we experience that season, because every season is shaped by the way we talk about it. And our attitude starts to align with the words that we use. So if you're in an extremely busy season right now, many of us are, and I have a parent class, busy parenting, or busy families, just a quick ad for that on Wednesday nights. And all the responsibilities seem to be overwhelming. You can't control the season that you're in. You can't always make it less busy. But you can change the way that you talk about it. Instead of saying, we're so maxed out right now, we can say, guess what? My life is full. Instead of saying, our to-do list never gets done, we can say, I have a great reason to get up tomorrow morning and get started. Instead of saying I'm overwhelmed by dealing with my aging parents, for example, we can say, I'm glad that my mother and father are still alive so I can have a relationship with them, even if it's difficult. What we say about our season will shape the way that we experience our season. If we speak God's promises over the season, we speak about God's faithfulness in our season, then he will open our eyes to see the beauty in it, because God makes everything beautiful in its time. Psalm 1:1-3 says, "Blessed are those who do not walk in step with the wicked or stand in the way that sinners take or sit in the company of mockers, but who delight in the law of the Lord and meditate on his law day and night. They are like a tree planted by the streams of water, which yields its fruit in season." They're like a tree that yields its fruit in season. Why? Because they're planted next to the streams of water. Have you ever been to a restaurant where they give you a pager? Well, we went to a restaurant. They gave us a pager. Told us it was going to be a 40-minute wait, which blows my mind. I can't deal with that very well. I hate to wait, so I thought, okay, we'll take the pager. We'll go wandering around some of the stores and kill some time. We came back after about 25 minutes, and they said, "Sorry, we already gave your table away. We buzzed your pager, but you didn't come." And I said, "Well, the pager never went off." And they said, "Well, you must have gone out of range. You were too far away." And I was like, oh. But that happens when you get discontent in your season. You start wandering away from God because you think the season is unbearable. And God says, "I was calling for you. I prepared a table for you. I had some blessings for you, but when the right time came, you didn't hear me. You wandered away too far." God is saying to us this morning, don't wander away. Stay close to me. Because when it's your time, I don't want you to miss your turn. And when your turn comes, I want you to be ready for it. So don't miss it. One more point this morning. So the first point is that every season has a struggle. The second is that every season is shaped by what you say. And finally, third, every season has strengths that you can seize. This kind of opposite of the first point. We said every season has struggles you can't see, but every season also has strengths you can seize. There was a man named Paul, not biblical Paul, but another guy, who wrote about a really difficult season in his life. There was a time when he was still working in the corporate marketing of General Electric, and they transferred him to an office in Cincinnati. A few years later, he took a job in Chicago. So Kathy, his wife, and he put up the house on the market, and they agreed that they would, as soon as it sold, they would move the family, his wife and three kids, up to Chicago. This plan was only supposed to last a few weeks, but the house didn't sell. And then it didn't sell. And then it still didn't sell. So 6 months later, the house still hadn't sold. So he's still commuting. So he's away from Kathy and their three young kids for five out of the 7 days of the week. And that's a difficult time. And then it got worse because the job in Chicago didn't turn out to be what he thought it would. It wasn't a good fit for him. So after a while, he started looking for another job back in the Cincinnati area. So for 6 months, he did a job search in the Cincinnati area while working a job in Chicago every week, commuting. Not only that, he was in a job that he didn't like. He was separated from his wife and kids most of the week. It was a miserable year. It was his miserable season. But in every season, there's a strength you can seize. You see, when he was living at home with the three kids, his time with God was limited. But during that year of commuting, he suddenly had way more time. And in particular, he had 10 hours of time in a car as he commuted backwards and forwards 5 hours each way. And he decided not to waste that time. So he did three things with each five-hour block that he had. He had the Bible on cassette tape. So it wasn't recently. And he started listening to that for a couple of hours. He had worship music on tape. And he started singing along in his car. And then he'd turn the music off and he'd pray to God and listen to God for the rest of the time. And when he heard God speak to him, he'd record it on a small pocket recorder that he had in his car while he was driving, so that he had 10 hours of Bible, worship, and prayer time every weekend. And that didn't include the time he spent at church or other regular times with God. He said that he grew more in his relationship with God during that year than he had for the whole of his life. You see, God was preparing him. And he had no idea at the time, but only a couple of years after that, he became a pastor at his church. That year of commuting was a difficult, painful season. But in every season, there's a strength you can seize. And God makes everything beautiful in its time. I can imagine God talking to his angels, and he's telling them, you see that guy there? He's pretty busy. He isn't spending a whole lot of time with me. But I really need to prepare him for something bigger. I wonder how I can do that. Then he goes, hey, I've got an idea. How about we put him in a car for 10 hours a week and see what he'll do with that? And it's going to be beautiful. Because God makes everything beautiful in its time. And if we take the time and make the effort, we'll be able to see the beautiful thing that God is doing in our season. We can't live in the season that was, and we can't make God change the next season right away. But there's a strength in this season that we can seize. We can't live in someone else's season. We've got to seize the strength of this season. We might not have what we used to have. We might not get what we used to get. But if we plant our roots down deep in God's purpose for us, God makes everything beautiful in its time. Please stand as we pray. Yay, I'm done. Heavenly Father, we are grateful for your purpose in our lives. Help us to understand that everything goes in phases and seasons. They don't always seem comfortable. In fact, many of them we don't want to do at all. But help us to find the purpose through the struggles, the strength through the pain. And help us to see the way forward in the plan that you have for us. We give thanks for your availability to us at all times to be able to find your purpose. And we pray these things in the name of Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.